more from the educator aspect, you have a struggling reader in your home, or if you want to get more involved with your child, foster child or biological child, that's what I'll be talking about for the next 30 or 40 minutes or so. So we've never had a placement in our home, but we do have a 4, almost 5-year-old little boy, and we are expecting another son in August. Just work with linearity is that age group, but I have dabbled in some middle school in the last couple of years with the dyslexia stuff because children there, we did catch them 5 years ago, and so we have to work on them right now. So being involved as a parent is sometimes welcomed by your children. I think my child who is four, he begs for me to go and come eat lunch with him, and I can't come eat lunch with him every day, but I don't think that would be the same 10 years from now. Whenever he's 14, I don't think he will be inviting me to his school to eat lunch with him. So I think that is sometimes welcome, but not always. And then depending on the I did love when my mom came to eat lunch with me as a child because it gave me extra attention, and I don't like a lot of attention on me, so it's hard to look at all of y'all looking at me right now. But I did, looking back, really, I didn't want it, even though I didn't ask for it that much. But parental involvement is important, whether your child is begging for it or they're wanting to push you away, it's important. And a simple way that you can get involved is to help with homework. Knowing what your child's learning at school, whether it's the math, whether it's, I know math is normally one of those subjects that the parents don't even know how to help them once they get past a certain grade level because it's changed from the way we learned it when we were in school. And so, but that you not understanding, if you contact the teacher, then the teacher, you can build a rapport with them and get more comfortable with the teacher that way. You can, in the elementary grades, become like a homeroom parent. And I appreciated, I don't have this now because I'm not a regular classroom teacher, but I appreciated parents coming in and wanting to do activities with our kids. Like Earth Day is Sunday, I think, or Monday. I forget if it's tomorrow or Sunday. But anyway, our school did a lot of things with Earth Day yesterday. They had parents come in and help, you know, pick up trash off the playground, or some classes planted little seeds and little flower pots and things. But parents were the ones who really initiated that. And as a teacher, it means a lot. It helps having that in there. And the child, I would think, just would love having you in there. You can help out with book fairs as they come around, even though middle school has those, or other fundraising events. Right now we're selling juice and popcorn every Friday for $1, and we have different parents that come up and help coordinate that, so the teachers are not the ones having to do it. So there's just lots of different things. You can contact your school, but in light of recent events in our country, schools also are wanting you to be, maybe have some special training or just verify that you are a good person, because there are a lot of good people out there who can do bad things in school. So just check with your school and any policies they may have before you do that. There's been studies that have shown that if you are involved in your child's education, whether it is just checking on their homework, which is very important, or you are in the school physically, that they are more likely finish school. So they're more likely to graduate. There's a higher rate of graduation. And they'll probably just enjoy it more. I would think they would act out less because you are up there, you are involved, they see you. They know, hopefully, if you build that rapport with the teachers, then you will know, they will know that the teacher will contact you if you have any issues, and will just be a support there. So since I do have the reading background, I printed off some importance of reading and ways that you can kind of get involved with your child. So I'm going to pass these around now, but as I'm passing, if anyone has any questions, feel free to raise your hand and I'll address them. show them a word on a flashcard, they can't read that word. They don't really know how to begin with that word. In kindergarten, they can only get by because they can memorize. Anybody can just about memorize a small number of words. But then once you get past that kindergarten age and into first grade, where the words are getting harder, the books are getting a little longer, the books are not as patterned. I know in our kindergarten school, it's like the dog can run. Well, it's a picture of a dog. You turn the page and it says the dog can eat. And you turn the page. And so it's very repetition. They catch on to that. They can pass those kind of books and do well on those kind of things because they're bright and they can see that. But yeah, whenever they get in first grade, their spelling will start to suffer. You don't hear. They have trouble hearing the sounds in words. So the word cat, they just hear it as cat, not as cat. And so that translates into more problems there with the spelling. They can't read the words. They're not, if they are reading, it's normally very slow and choppy. And then there's also just reading struggles too. So just because a child is struggling with reading doesn't mean they have dyslexia. There's different tests that we do to help us discriminate. Is it dyslexia or is it just another struggling with reading? We kind of joke in our building, a couple of teachers and I look at the data and have to help try to figure out who has what. We wonder, okay, is it dystonia, which is not really a thing, but they have not been taught well because they haven't been in school, they have poor attendance, they are sleeping through half of their classes, or is it really a reading struggle? So, yes, spelling is definitely part of dyslexia. That was the question that was asked. And like I said, they're normally really bright to kids. I work with some of the best and brightest kids in our building, I mean, but their test scores don't show that. But they're very bright, they have a great vocabulary, but when you put the vocabulary in front of them, they can't grasp it as well. So I did hand out the reading at home with your child, and there's a graphic on the back that I like. And I didn't realize how blurry it was until after I already made all the copies, and I did not want to reprint that many. But you can still read it. But it does just show how reading 20 minutes each day, but preferably at home, makes a really big difference throughout the 7 years of school, kindergarten through sixth grade. Student A, who reads 20 minutes a day, that ends up being 3,600 minutes in a school year, which is 1,800,000 words by the time they finish sixth grade. So that is great. And then 5 minutes is better than nothing, right? Well, it's 900 minutes in the school year, and it's 282,000 words that they've read in that kindergarten through sixth grade time. And then student C, who reads 1 minute a day, which I really doubt anyone's reading just for 1 minute. It's probably really zero, but just for the illustration purposes, 180 minutes in the school year, and then 8,000 words. And the little words under the bookshelf is the 90th percentile, the 50th percentile, and the 10th percentile. And that's just saying that they 90th percentile in that category, they will read better and have a better vocabulary than 90 other kids their same age will grade level. Like they will be in that top 90%. 50th percentile, that's right in the middle, and then the 10th percentile.
It's like raised up, I'm still a foster parent, I'm working, but.
Great. So, reading at home is important, reading at school is important, but the home is what is, sometimes we get too busy for. I'm a teacher, I'm a dyslexic therapist, I love to read myself, but I don't have a lot of time to read for pleasure anymore, with working and keeping up with him and his activities and things. But we don't necessarily carve out the time every day for 20 whole minutes, but I will have him at bedtime. go back. And he thinks they're still going to have the superhero stuff, even though we've been several times and they haven't had that thing. He still thinks that. So read to them daily. And then talk about the books after reading to them. You can read the same book several times. And those are the books my kid or my child will pick up to read whenever I make him go read for 5 or 10 minutes. It's the ones that I've read to him that he's memorized the story from. And he just flips through the pages and I can get him to talk him through the story. And he may forget details, but it's just fostering that love for it. And then that quote at the bottom, I've seen the quote through Facebook over the years here and there, but children are made readers on the laps of their parents. And you just definitely can foster that love for reading by reading to them, giving them your love for reading. And then the next page is how to help communicate with your child. I know that the previous speaker did mention how relationship is important, and this will help foster that relationship. Instead of asking, well, how was your day, because most people would respond with good or bad or boring, whenever you're picking them up from school, when they get home from school, just go deeper and ask them some deeper questions, like, what was the hardest thing you had to do today? Who did you sit with at lunch? What did you eat for lunch? That's what my son's only 4, so he, if I asked him the hardest thing he did today, I don't know that he would be able to answer that question, but I do ask him a lot about his lunch and what did you eat and what didn't you eat, because I try to make him eat in the cafeteria as much as possible, mainly because it's less work on me and I don't have to worry about the lunch box every day, but he's not really picky and I like him to try new things, and so if they have lasagna and salad and a roll and maybe some like carrots or something, I don't know, I'll ask him, what did you eat? What did you like? Did you try this? And his teacher's really good too to make him try it. At least take one bite, you know, so it helps me, me figure out if he really is eating enough that day or not. Because some days he comes home and he's like, I just took one bite and I didn't like it, and so I didn't eat a lot. And I can tell because he's really hungry when eating a snack right then. That's a question I ask a lot is about his food. But then you can ask your older children, who did you sit by at lunch? What did y'all talk about? What are you looking forward to school for tomorrow? Is there anything going on this week or this month? Or the older children, you have a dance coming up. So that sort of thing. Did you get frustrated with anything at school today? Did something upset you? Is it? And then if you see patterns happening with that question of you're always frustrated in math, or you're always frustrated in PE, then you can start trying to dig deeper with those things and see if it's a child that's frustrating them, is it the teacher, is it the content and the actual things that they're learning that's frustrating? But just going deeper than how was your day, because you don't get a lot of information from that usually. And then maybe how did you help somebody, or how did you help yourself, and that could, you know, how did someone help you, or how did you help someone? Sorry, I misspoke. That could help even branch into a kindness discussion and how you should be helping others and look for ways to help others. And I think even my 4-year-old could grasp that concept. He still needs help in his pants and things like that. And so he could tell me, well, you know, Miss Chandra, but my pants for me. And, well, how did you help someone? Oh, I picked up, I helped, you know, came and clean up the box and just things like that. So I think So there'd be